So hello all. So let's discuss about the third topic of hematology or blood coagulation, that is fibrinolytics or antifibrinolytics. Okay. Now what do we mean by the word fibrinolytics? These drugs, they will degrade or lyse fibrin. Okay. They will degrade the fibrin which has been deposited in the blood vessel. Okay. So let's discuss first about fibrinolytics. Okay. Because of this reason, they will dissolve a blood clot. They will dissolve blood clot. So if the clot or the thrombus have been formed, it will remove this thrombus which already has been formed. Okay? So it will remove or dissolve the blood clot, thrombus. But remember, fibrinolytics are different from anticoagulants. If you talk about the drugs known as anticoagulants like heparin and warfarin, anticoagulants, they prevent deposition of fibrin. Anticoagulants, they prevent deposition of fibrin. But what about fibrinolytics? Remember, fibrinolytics, they will remove the fibrin which is already been deposited. Okay? It will remove the deposited fibrin. So if I'll ask you a question, which of the following drug will remove a clot which have already been formed by fibrin? The answer will be fibrinolytics. So anticoagulant, they prevent deposition of fibrin, while fibrinolytic, they will remove the deposited fibrin. Okay? Now, keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about first fibrinolytics. Okay? Let's talk about the drugs first, fibrinolytics, which is also known as thrombolytic drugs. Okay. Now let's see how normally thrombolysis occurs in our blood. Remember, suppose this is a blood vessel. Okay. And these are the endothelial cell. And because of endothelial cell, there is deposition of fibrin. Okay. There is deposition of fibrin. Let's see how normally fibrinolysis occurs. There is a protein in our blood known as plasminogen. Okay? Now this plasminogen, remember, is in free form, it is circulating. Now this plasminogen comes and attach on the surface of fibrin. Okay? This plasminogen comes and attach on the surface of fibrin. This is known as bound plasminogen. Okay? This is known as bound plasminogen. But right now this plasminogen is in inactive form. As you are seeing, ogen word is coming. Plasminogen right now is an inactive form. Now what will happen? These endothelial cells, they release a factor into the blood known as TPA. TPA stands for tissue plasminogen activator. This tissue plasminogen activator in our body, it specifically converts bound plasminogen into active form known as plasmin. Okay? It will convert this bound plasminogen into active form plasmin. Now remember, this plasmin is an active form and it is a type of protease enzyme. And this protease enzyme, remember, degrades fibrin. And various fibrin degrading products are formed. One of the product which is formed after degradation of fibrin is known as D-dimer. So D-dimer is a molecule which is formed after degradation of fibrin, which is used to assess the level of fibrinolysis in the body. Okay? But tell me, if there is excessive fibrinolysis, what will happen? If there is excessive fibrinolysis or excessive removal of fibrin, don't you think it will start bleeding? So excessive fibrinolytic drugs will cause bleeding. Because to prevent excessive fibrinolytic drugs, these endothelial cells, they release a factor known as PAI 1 and 2. Now, what do we mean by the word PAI 1 and 2? PAI 1 and 2 stands for plasminogen activator. The thing which is activating plasminogen, it will inhibit that. प्लाज्मिनोजन एक्टिवेटर इनहिबिटर. सो कैन यू टेल मी विच मॉलिक्यूल वॉज एक्टिवेटिंग प्लाज्मिनोजन? दैट वॉज टीपीए, टिश्यू प्लाज्मिनोजन एक्टिवेटर. दिस पीएआई 1 and 2 इनहिबिट्स टीपीए. बिकॉज ऑफ दिस रीजन एक्सेसिव फिब्रिनोलाइसिस इज प्रिवेंटेड बाय पीएआई 1 and 2. सो इट विल इनहिबिट टीपीए. सो इट विल इनहिबिट फिब्रिनोलाइसिस. ओके, इट विल इनहिबिट फिब्रिनोलाइसिस. ओके, so keep this thing in mind. Let's talk about the drugs we have among fibrinolytics. Okay, let's talk about the drugs we have among fibrinolytics or thrombolytics. Before coming to the drug, remember what is their mechanism of action. Remember, these drugs, they also activate plasminogen into active form plasmin. So the mechanism of action of fibrinolytic is they convert plasminogen into plasmin. But remember, unlike the body TPA, which is selective for bound plasminogen, they activate both bound plasminogen and free plasminogen. They activate both bound and free plasminogen. So don't you think if plasminogen will be converted into plasmin in whole body, it will produce fibrinolysis in whole body? Because of excessive fibrinolysis, these drugs, they will produce a very dangerous side effect, that these drugs may cause fatal bleeding. Okay, because of overactivation of plasminogen into plasmin, they may cause fatal bleeding, and this is acute bleeding, and the patient can die suddenly. It could be acute bleeding which is seen in internal organs, and the patient may die suddenly. Because of these drugs, remember, these fibrinolytics, they are very dangerous drugs. They are highly dangerous drug. And remember, they are only given in some emergency life-threatening situation. They are only given in some emergency or life-threatening situation. Otherwise, we don't use these fibrinolytic drugs routinely. They are only given in some emergency or life-threatening situation. Okay. Now, what is the route of administration? The route of administration of all these drugs which we will be discussing, they are given IV, intravenously. Okay. They are given intravenously. So, let's classify what are the drugs we have. Okay. Among fibrinolytics. So, the drugs among fibrinolytics, we can divide them into two. Either they are natural compounds, natural products, we will write, or we can divide them into recombinant TPA. Okay, TPA is tissue plasminogen activator. So let's write the names of first natural products. The first drug among fibrinolytic which is a natural product is streptokinase. Okay, streptokinase. Okay, second we can write as urokinase. Among recombinant human TPA, we will write the drugs are eltiplase, retiplase, and tenecteplase. Okay, tenecteplase. These are the drugs among recombinant TPA. How to remember? Kinase word is coming, tiplase word is coming. Okay, tiplase TPA. Now let's talk about first streptokinase. First point we will write that what are their half-life. The half-life of streptokinase is around, we will write, is around 18 minutes. Okay, half-life is around 18 minutes. Urokinase is around 15 minutes. Eltiplase, we will write, is 5 minutes. Retiplase, 18 minutes. And tenecteplase, we will write, is around 20 minutes. Okay, 10 and 10, 20 we can remember. Now, why is streptokinase is known as a natural product? Because this streptokinase is obtained from, It is obtained from, we will write beta, it is obtained from beta hemolytic streptococci. Okay, it is obtained from beta hemolytic streptococci, while urokinase is obtained from human urine. That is why it is known as urokinase. But nowadays we are obtaining them from cultured kidney cells. Cultured kidney cells. Now, what is the problem do you think is with streptokinase? Now, can we say that this streptokinase is a streptococcal antigen? It is given as an antigen. Because of this reason, it will produce antibodies. Because of this reason, we only give streptokinase once in a lifetime. Okay? We give streptokinase once in a lifetime. The reason is, if you will give this streptokinase again, what will happen? There is already formation of antibodies against this streptococcal antigen, and those antibodies will not allow streptokinase to function. But remember, all other drugs, they can be given, they are non-antigenic, they can be given multiple times. So all other drugs are non-antigenic, they are also non-antigenic, and they can be given multiple times. Okay, now what is the dose of streptokinase? You have to remember. So streptokinase dose is around, dose of streptokinase we will write is 0.5 to 1.5 lakh units IV, okay, IV over, it is given as a continuous infusion over 1 hour, okay. So remember, streptokinase require continuous infusion. While if you talk about these last two drugs, retiprolase and tenecteplase, these drugs, remember, they don't require continuous infusion. Don't require any continuous infusion. They are just given, retiprolase and tenecteplase, they are given as a single. We will write that retiprolase, they are given single IV bolus. Bolus means one big injection. This retiprolase is given as a twice a day bolus injection, while tenecteplase is given once a day bolus injection. Okay? Because of this reason, retiprolase and tenecteplase, they are known as bolus fibrinolytics. Apart from this, all other drugs, they are given as a continuous IV infusion. While retiprolase and tenecteplase, they are not given continuously, they are given as a single large injection, not continuous fashion. Okay? No continuous fashion. Okay? So, let's talk about these drugs, eltiprolase, retiprolase and tenecteplase. If you talk about eltiprolase, eltiprolase is exactly recombinant human TPA. Okay, and it is given by continuous infusion because it's a very short acting drug. Then we have made retiprolase is modified form of eltiprolase. Because of its modification, it becomes a longer acting preparation. Okay, while tenecteplase is the best drug we have, tenecteplase is sometimes known as mutant TPA. Mutant TPA stands for that we have changed the amino acid sequence of this TPA, tissue plasminogen activator protein. Okay, we have changed the amino acid sequence in such a way that it has become resistant to inhibition by PAI1 and 2. PAI1 and 2 was plasminogen activator inhibitor. It is resistant to PAI1 and 2. And remember, it is more specific for bound plasminogen. It is more specific for bound plasminogen as compared to free plasminogen. So it is more safer in function also. So tenecteplase is considered as a best drug. and the dose of tenecteplase, you must have remember, it is half the body weight. Whatever the body weight is, make this dose half. So it is around 0.5 milligram per kg. So in a 60 kg man, you will give 30 milligram of the dose. In 70 kg man, you will give 35 milligram of a single bolus intravenously of tenecteplase. Okay, tenecteplase. Now remember, these are the drugs. Now remember, there are certain new drugs as well. Those new drugs we will write is desmotiplase. Now right now this desmotiplase is not approved, but you will write this desmotiplase overall is the longest acting drug. Its half-life is 138 minutes. It is overall the longest acting drug. Right now it is not approved. Now this desmotiplase is obtained, generally found in saliva of vampires. It is found in saliva of vampires. Second drug we will write is elfmiprase. It is found in saliva of, or sorry, it is found in venom of copperhead snake. It is found in venom of copperhead snake. But what is expected? Try to remember desmotiplase, because it is the longest acting drug we have. Okay. Now let's talk about the uses of fibrinolytics. Okay. Uses of fibrinolytics. Can we say that fibrinolytics will dissolve a clot and it will open a blood vessel? Okay. So it is given in very serious condition. The main use of fibrinolytic is, first is stroke. And it is given in acute stroke. Okay. Now remember, there are two kinds of stroke. One is known as hemorrhagic stroke due to bleeding. Okay. The second is known as ischemic stroke due to blockage of blood vessel. Can you tell me in which stroke would you like to remove a clot? In hemorrhagic or ischemic? Remember, we give fibrinolytics in ischemic stroke. We give him given ischemic stroke. Remember, fibrinolytics are absolutely contraindicated in hemorrhagic stroke, because already there is bleeding in hemorrhagic stroke. With fibrinolytic, you don't want to increase the further risk of bleeding. Okay? So they are given in ischemic stroke. They are absolutely contraindicated in hemorrhagic stroke. And what is the time? If a patient of ischemic stroke will come, remember, it should be given ideally within 3 hours. Fibrinolytic should be given ideally within 3 hours. Okay, but it can be given up to 4.5 hours. Okay, so in stroke, fibrinolytics, they have a role up to 4.5 hours only, and ideal time is up to 3 hours, okay, after a stroke. Now the second use of fibrinolytics is you will write ST elevated MI. That is ST elevated myocardial infarction. Okay. Now remember, myocardial infarction is a part of a syndrome known as acute coronary syndrome. Okay, acute coronary syndrome. Acute coronary syndrome means there is sudden blockage of coronary artery. Sudden blockage of coronary artery. Hence, the main treatment of acute coronary syndrome is to open this coronary artery very fast. When you open the coronary artery, this therapy is known as reperfusion therapy. This therapy is known as reperfusion therapy. Reperfusion therapy means opening of coronary artery. And reperfusion therapy, remember, can be done only up to, we will open the coronary artery only up to 12 hours. Opening of coronary artery should be done after 12 hours of MI. Now remember, this acute coronary syndrome is divided into three types. ACS or acute coronary syndrome is divided into three parts. The first is known as unstable angina. Okay, unstable angina. Second is known as NSTEMI, non-ST elevated MI. And the third one is known as ST elevated MI. Okay, ST elevated MI. What happens? We differentiate them on the basis of ECG and cardiac biomarkers. We differentiate them on the basis of ECG and cardiac biomarkers like cardiac troponin, because all of them will have same presentation. Now what happens in unstable angina? There is blockage of coronary artery, but what will happen to the myocardium? In myocardium, there is just ischemia, there is no dead cell. So ECG will show ST depression, and cardiac troponins are the proteins which are present in the muscles of the heart. As the muscles of the heart is normal in angina, there is only ischemia, there will be no cardiac troponin proteins, they will come into the blood from heart. While in non-ST elevated MI, MI means myocardial infarction, remember there is a very small infarct. So there is a partial thickness infarct, because of this reason there is ST depression, but cardiac biomarkers will come into the blood. While in ST elevated MI, remember there is whole thickness infarct, full thickness infarct, this is known as transmural infarct also. Because of this reason, whole thickness infarct, there is ST elevation with cardiac biomarkers positive. So you can differentiate them on the basis of this. Now whether it is of any type of acute coronary syndrome, we have to open the coronary artery, which is known as reperfusion therapy. Now we can do reperfusion therapy in two ways. Either we will give a drug known as fibrinolytics, okay, or what we can do, we can give fibrinolytic which will dissolve a clot, or we can give an optical fiber probe and we will open a balloon out here. This is known as PCI. PCI is known as percutaneous coronary intervention, like balloon angioplasty. Balloon angioplasty, we will do this. Okay, now the point is, in unstable angina, remember we don't do fibrinolytics, and in ST elevated MI we don't give fibrinolytic, here we only give PCI. The reason is, fibrinolytics, they are very dangerous drugs. Fibrinolytics, they are very dangerous drug, they may increase the risk of bleeding, and the patient may die due to bleeding. Rather, the less severe forms of MI, unstable angina and NSTEMI, they are less severe form. So use of fibrinolytic is more risky as compared to the mortality of NSTEMI and unstable angina. But if you talk about ST elevated MI, ST elevated MI is a very dangerous condition. It has a very high mortality rate. In this condition, remember, we give fibrinolytic initially because they can be given very faster, and then we plan for definitive PCI. Okay, so fibrinolytics, remember, they are only given in ST elevated MI. Okay, now if a patient of ST elevated MI comes to us, then how we will give fibrinolytic? Remember, for ST elevated MI, the best treatment is PCI. The best treatment is PCI. But remember, the drawbacks of best PCI is, it takes time. It is time consuming. But if you talk about fibrinolytic are the drug we can give very faster. So what will happen if a patient on STEMI comes to us? What we will do, we will give fibrinolytics. Now until at how much time we will give fibrinolytic? When a patient comes, we start fibrinolytic. This is known as door to needle time. This is known as door to needle time. So whenever the patient comes to the hospital door, give fibrinolytic. This is known as door to needle time. This is within 30 minutes. Okay. But if you are planning to do PCI, balloon angioplasty, this is known as door to balloon time. So the ideal time of door to balloon time is within 60 minutes. ओके विद इन 60 मिनट्स. ओके तो डू बलून एंजियोप्लास्टी द टाइम इज विद इन 60 मिनट्स. तो फिब्रिनोलिटिक्स दे कैन बी गिवन अर्ली. ओके दिस इज द इंपॉर्टेंस. नाउ द थर्ड यूज ऑफ फिब्रिनोलिटिक्स द थर्ड यूज ऑफ फिब्रिनोलिटिक्स अपार्ट फ्रॉम MI इज इट इज गिवन इन केसेस ऑफ पल्मोनरी एम्बोलिज्म. ओके इन केसेस ऑफ पल्मोनरी एम्बोलिज्म. Now what happens in pulmonary embolism? It mainly occurs due to DVT when there is formation of thrombus in the leg veins. Leg veins means deep venous thrombosis. It may go into the heart. From heart, it can enter into the lungs, which is known as pulmonary embolism because the capillaries of the lungs are very small. Remember, the drug of choice for pulmonary embolism is anticoagulants. Anticoagulants, they prevent the deposition of this fibrin in lungs, like low molecular weight heparin, okay, or oral warfarin. But think about, they will prevent the deposition of fibrin, but think about there is massive pulmonary embolism. If there is massive pulmonary embolism, that means the patient is dying due to hypoxia. Why there is hypoxia? Because there is acute respiratory distress syndrome. There is severe lung injury. Or because of this reason, the right heart is failing. There is right heart failure because of massive pulmonary embolism. Now, can we say that the patient may die due to this condition? If there is massive pulmonary embolism, then we will add a drug known as fibrinolytics. Okay? So fibrinolytics, remember, they are only given in massive pulmonary embolism. Otherwise, the drug of choice for pulmonary embolism is anticoagulants. Okay? And the last point is, they are also given sometimes in DVT. DVT stands for deep venous thrombosis. Now, deep venous thrombosis occurs in leg veins when a person remains in a chronic standing posture. The blood finds very difficult to move anti-gravity towards the heart. So, in leg veins, a fibrin-rich thrombi is formed. So, can we say the blood will find very difficult to move upwards? So, generally what happens, the blood finds alternative channels to move upwards. So, these alternative channels through superficial leg veins are known as perforators. So, it will go from superficial leg veins. If there is formation of a thrombus in a deep leg vein, now the blood will form from flow from superficial leg veins. These are superficial veins. But with time, due to high pressure, these superficial leg veins or perforators, they also get damaged. Now, the only route by which the blood can go to the heart is this main deep vein. Now, the only route which is left is main deep vein if the perforators have been damaged. Because if the blood will not go into the heart, the blood will remain in the legs. It will lead to congestion and infection, and we have to cut the limb of the patient. So, in DVT, if you want to preserve the main deep vein, then we sometimes give fibrinolytics. We will remove this thrombus directly. Okay? When you want to preserve this deep main vein, then we will give DVT. Otherwise, fibrinolytic drugs, they are reserve drug. Generally, we don't use fibrinolytic drug. They are used only in severe conditions because they may cause acute fatal bleeding. So, they are very dangerous drug. They can cause acute fatal bleeding. Okay? So, keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about the contraindications of using fibrinolytics. What are the contraindications of fibrinolytics? Where we will not use them? So, there is absolute contraindication and relative contraindication. Relative means we should use these drugs with highly precaution. With high caution, we should use in those certain scenarios. So, absolute contraindication, we will never even think of using them. So, the first absolute contraindication of using fibrinolytic is, we will write, if the patient has hemorrhagic stroke. Okay. Second, so hemorrhagic stroke is an absolute contraindication. We will write ischemic stroke in past 3 months. Okay. Ischemic stroke in past 3 months. Okay. Third point, we will write head and face trauma in past 3 months because it can lead to bleeding, internal cranial bleed, patient can die suddenly. You will write malignant hypertension because it will lead to rupture of blood vessel. Now malignant hypertension means the BP is more than 180 by 110, sorry 120. 180 by 120 is known as malignant hypertension, but here we will write 110. Okay. Now, aortic dissection. Aorta is already ruptured, so don't give fibrinolytic, it will lead to complete rupture. Okay. Active internal bleeding. Already there is internal bleeding, don't give fibrinolytic. And last point is you can write malignant intracranial neoplasm. So it's not important to cram each and every word of this list. Remember, in all these conditions, don't you think there will be some increased risk of bleeding? Trauma will lead to bleeding, hypertension will lead to bleeding, dissection, that means rupturing of artery, already there is bleeding, intracranial neoplasm will also bleed. So try to remember, if there is some high risk of bleeding, don't give fibrinolytic. Okay. Now if you talk about relative contraindication, we will write pregnancy. Okay, use with certain precaution. Peptic ulcers. Okay, recent surgery. Recent surgery means surgery within last 3 weeks. Because the wounds will not close properly, fibrinolytic will lead to wound dehiscence. Again, there will be bleeding. And concomitant anticoagulant use, if you are using them with anticoagulants like heparin, etc. Okay, concomitant anticoagulant use. So these contraindications, these are the contraindication of fibrinolytics. Now let's talk about a drug which is opposite to fibrinolytic. They are known as antifibrinolytic. Okay, antifibrinolytics, they are also known as antithrombolytics. Okay, antithrombolytics. Now what is the mechanism of action of these drugs? Remember, these drugs, they inhibit activation of plasminogen, just opposite to fibrinolytic. They inhibit activation of plasminogen into active form plasmin. Fibrinolytics were promoting it, antifibrinolytic will inhibit activation. Okay. Remember, these drugs, they mimic one endogenous substance. They mimic one endogenous substance known as alpha-2 antiplasmin. So there is a protein in our blood which inhibits the conversion of plasminogen into active form antiplasmin directly. Okay, which is generally synthesized by the liver. So let's talk about what are the drugs we have among antifibrinolytics. Okay, remember these drugs, they can be given orally, they can be given IV. Okay, and among them, remember we just have two drugs and they are very important for you. The first drug we will write is tranexamic acid, antifibrinolytic. And second we have is epsilon amino caproic acid. Okay, which is short form is known as EACA. Okay, epsilon amino caproic acid. Now remember, earlier we had one drug which is now not used. That drug was eprotenin. So eprotenin was also a antifibrinolytic, but remember it is now out of use. So the only drug among antifibrinolytics we have now is tranexamic acid and epsilon amino caproic acid. So these are the drugs we have among antifibrinolytics. Okay. Now let's see where these drugs are used and what is their special property. Remember, this tranexamic acid is much longer acting drug and it can be given orally and IV. Epsilon amino caproic acid is very shorter acting drug and it is only given IV. Okay, so it is more preferred. So what are the uses of these antifibrinolytic? The first use is they are antidote for fibrinolytics. So these drugs are the antidote for fibrinolytic because fibrinolytics, they cause acute fatal bleeding. Okay, and they are also used in cases of to control active internal bleeding. They are used to control active internal bleeding. So let's talk about certain causes of active internal bleeding. Like in hemophilias, there is active internal bleeding. Okay, we will write menorrhagia, especially due to IUCD insertion. When we insert IUCD, it can lead to menorrhagia. It is also given in trauma, special facial trauma. Okay, during cardiopulmonary bypass, if there is bleeding, we give these drugs suddenly. Okay, so these are the certain causes of active internal bleeding. Okay, so they are given in active internal bleeding. To control active internal bleeding, we give them. Okay, just one additional point, that this tranexamic acid, only this tranexamic acid, remember, it also decreases melanin production from melanocytes. Remember, plasmin, if we inhibit the conversion of plasminogen into plasmin, plasmin normally activates melanin also. Okay, so it will decrease pigmentation. So it is a kind of hypopigmenting agent. So the skin pigmentation will reduce. Melanin increases skin pigmentation. So it is hypopigmenting agent. So it will reduce the pigmentation of skin. Because of this reason, tranexamic acid is also used in the treatment of hyperpigmentation of skin known as melasma, which is also known as cloasma. Melasma and cloasma, what is it? Is due to hyperpigmentation of skin. In melasma, there is hyperpigmentation of skin due to OCP use. OCP stands for oral contraceptive pills use. Okay, especially estrogen containing. So tranexamic acid can also be used as a hypopigmenting agent. So this is all about fibrinolytics and about hematology. So thank you very much.